I got to hurry. I got the call from one of the studios that I freelance at. Very apologetic office manager saying, can you come in this afternoon? I've been planning on doing this episode this afternoon and getting it online. But they've got some folks that need to come in, and this is the only time they can do it. And I'm saying, yeah, sure, I'll be there. But you guys on hold, get this recorded real quick. It's almost 1 o'clock on Tuesday. So we'll get this recorded real quick, and then tonight I'll stay up late and get it online. All right, so this is Ham Radio Now, episode 159. I'm going to call this one CSI Dayton. Clickbait. Another clickbait. CSI. Yes, there's footage left from Dayton, quite a bit of it. When was Dayton? It was in May. This is the end of July. Still milking the footage from that. Still some interesting stuff to get going from there. And this isn't all of it. Just three quick shots of fairly short interviews to stuff into one episode. And then I'll talk about some other stuff at the end here, if I've got time before I've got to run. What's in CSI Dayton? Well, it's the whole title, CSI Dayton plus D-Star and the Dongles. This sounds like a backup group. they should perform at the next, they don't do banquets at Dayton. There's a musical group that occasionally does something at the, what is it, the contest group or the DX group? Ward Silver's been in that. D-Star and the Dongles would be a good musical group. Before we do anything else, though, I need to take a look at something here quick. That's just my big ugly face. This here, again, this is Tuesday at 1 o'clock in the afternoon Eastern Daylight Time, and we are hanging on by a thread here. We've just crossed the goal line for the Kickstarter to get me out to Austin to record the 2014 Tapper and ARL Digital Communications Conference. The goal is $8,000. We're currently sitting at $8,035. Now, that is not a done deal because we got the 59 hours to go. It ends Thursday night at 11:59 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. And people can withdraw their pledges. In fact, it was a little bit higher earlier today or last night, and somebody withdrew a $50 pledge. It can happen. I don't know why someone would initially pledge something and then decide to withdraw it. It could be I pissed them off somehow. Not that I've ever done that to anybody. But so it's kind of hanging in there by a thread. None of the $2,000 pledge levels have been accepted yet. And it's always possible that one of those will be taken, or possible that all three will, but kind of not counting on that. Maybe that will happen. And that would give us enough padding that we're in really good shape. Otherwise, we're hanging on by a thread. So, got my fingers crossed. Got to wait until Thursday night. We'll see if we actually succeed with the Kickstarter, but at least we're dithering across the line. Looks pretty good. And most of you will be watching this long after that's all over with. Some of you years from now, and saying, "What the heck is he talking about?" All right, let's do CSI Dayton. The first interview that we'll look at is Jerry Wanger. Jerry's got a call sign now. I'll let him tell you about the call sign in this episode. He is the owner, CEO, chief programmer, all that stuff, for a company called CSI, Connect Systems, Inc. The big deal about them was revealed here in episode 138 that I called Moto Turbo Star. Jerry has got some handheld radios out and coming up some mobile radios that do DMR, Moto Turbo, and analog FM. And they're a bunch cheaper than everybody else's. Not specifically designed for hams, but kind of leaning toward the ham radio market. He discovered the ham radio market. It's all in this this episode. So if you want to learn more about that, stop by episode 138. So I caught up with him at Dayton because he's got another product. The DMR FM radio is the CS700, but he was telling us about a new product. That's what the Moto Turbo Star is, the CS7000, that will have initially D-Star in analog, and it would be the first commercially available radio, not jeeped together with extra stuff hanging off of it, the first commercially available radio that will do D-Star, not made by ICOM. And it's promised to be fairly inexpensive. He'll tell you about it in this episode. Still looking at sometime in the fall. But that's only half the story. The rest of the story is that he wants to add other digital modes. And might as well just let him tell you all about it. So let's head back to Dayton from way last May. And our first one, we'll talk to Jerry Wanger. Then coming up, we're going to talk to Jim McClellan, N5MIJ. Jim, I'll introduce him in between the two episodes. If you don't remember who Jim is, pretty fascinating guy. We'll be talking about some D-Star stuff. And then we'll round things out with Robin Cutshaw, AA4RC. Robin had a booth at Dayton, and he's got some new products coming out, and he is rocking Google. Try it again. Rocking Google Glass. It's harder to say than it seems. So we'll round things out with a short interview with Robin as well. So now back to Dayton, and here's Jerry Wanger, CSI Dayton. So this is what you look like without the Skype fuzz.
Exactly.
Jerry, it's good to see you live and in person here at Dayton.
Yeah, it's glad to be here and glad to speak to Ham Radio now.
So this is the toy that we were talking about on the program a couple of months ago. This is the 700, and this radio does...
This thing does DMR and also analog. So it does both wideband and narrowband. It's also part 90, which means you can do commercial.
And it is programmable right from the keyboard?
Not right now. We'll have that version available about August. Right now it's strictly programmable from a computer.
Okay, and you're still working on the 7000, which will do what?
That'll do both D-Star. It's going to start out with D-Star and analog. Then we're going to migrate to also be able to do DMR, P25, NXDN, Fusion, and DPMR.
So every digital mode you can cram in?
Almost every. We're limited to FM modulation, meaning that we have a C-class amplifier in the radio.
And do you have a licensing issue as well?
When you say licensing, for...
For proprietary codecs and things like that?
Yes. Specifically, we have to buy a chip from DVSI to use their AMBRI coders. We have to pay a fee to Motorola if we use DMR. NXDN, as far as I know, requires no license. And D-Star, as far as I know, requires no license.
Okay, and you had sent me a press release that you have some extra information that you were releasing about this 7000, and I only went through it real quick, so I can't say what it is, but you probably can.
Basically, I told you what the 7000 is. The 7000 is going to be unique in the amateur world in that we're releasing the entire software in source code of what's in it. That will allow the user base, which is about 3.2 million potential hams, to not only use their radio, they could add different applications, they can put in different formats, they can, improve on what we did. And being that putting in all these different formats, such as P25 and NXDN, is so time-consuming, and there's already groups that are working on those formats in the amateur community, they can put those things into that radio themselves.
So you don't have to do all the work, you can let the open source or the ham community contribute what they really want.
That's the idea. And if they don't, once you develop a product and if the ham, community says, we don't like exactly how this thing works, we provide the source code so they can change it to make it exactly how they like it.
What kind of response have you been getting here at Dayton? This is your first trip, right?
Yeah,
right. So by the way, Dayton Virgin!
Yeah, so far it's been excellent. Been getting a lot of people, especially with the 7000, dropping by and asking questions. The 700 is well known throughout the amateur community by word of mouth. And, you know, a lot of people are thanking us for the work we're doing. It allows them to get into DMR radio, you know, at a relatively inexpensive price, you know, $180 versus at least 2 to 3 times that for the competitors.
And then adding a radio that's going to do even more modes that kind of solves or at least addresses that splintering problem that we're seeing happening.
Exactly. And the basic radio for that, we're selling at $199. And if they want the Wi-Fi module, which is for some exotic applications, it's only $50 more.
That's pretty amazing. Are you still looking for a fall release on that radio?
We are. Hopefully it's going to be November. But it's too early to know for sure if we're going to have any major problems that's going to prevent us from getting that date. I'll have actual hardware available in about 30 days for me to start testing. But the firmware, which is the harder part, is hopefully will be finished by November to start testing.
Good deal. When I talked to you, you had not become a ham yet. I think that situation has changed.
Yes, I'm now KK6 LFS.
Are you getting on the air and talking to people?
I had no time yet.
Yeah, keep designing radios.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I like about you know, this business. I like designing, you know, products. That's my, you know, primary focus. And being that I own a company, I could do what I want. So that's why we're developing the 7000.
Yeah, and there's a lot of hams that don't particularly want to talk. They want to design and build and tinker with stuff. And once it's built, move on to something else. Let somebody else talk with it. Let me talk with it.
Exactly.
Yep. So let me take a look at this in your hand. That gives us a better idea of what the size looks like, and it's a pretty compact radio.
Yeah, and the 7000 is going to be the exact same case. The only difference from the outside, instead of saying 700, it's going to say 7000. The inside is going to be significantly different, but the outside, you know, is exactly this.
Some things I'm thinking about, especially in terms of D-Star, your display is not real big. So there's going to be a limited amount of information on it. ICOM has tended to make big displays with lots of information about what the radio is doing. Have you started to figure out how you're going to be able to cram all that stuff on the little screen?
Yes. We're going to have a scrolling type of menu. So you can put as much as you want. And you'll have a hierarchy of menus. So you start out with one scrolling menu, and you start a number, and we'll go to another menu, and so forth. So you'll either be able to watch it go by without remembering anything, or if you have a memory, you know, good memory, you can just automatically put in the numbers without looking at what's on the display.
And like most people prefer to do all the serious programming with a computer, and this is computer programming.
Exactly. Although I've been finding a lot of people really rather do it from the keypad rather than from the computers.
So you have to make it work well for both.
Exactly.
All right. Is there anything else about this we haven't covered?
That's pretty much everything. You know, I'll release a white paper on our website. It's already available on CS7000 Yahoo group.
And you are going to be taking advance orders here. Has anybody actually bought one yet?
Yeah, we sold so far within the show, I'd say, about 40 of these 7000s. But before the show, just based upon the Yahoo group, I've gotten orders for close to 100 more.
Now, most of those are from people watching our show.
Probably.
Right. All right. Thank you very much, Jerry. It's good seeing you live and in person.
You're welcome.
And we will Skype again sometime when you've got an update.
Okay. Thank you.
I took a look at Jerry's website, CSI Connect Systems, and none of the stuff he's talking about was there as of today, maybe coming up sometime soon. At least I hope so. It's a little bit before his timeline. He was talking about sometime in August to put some things up there, and this is late July, so and we'll see. He has bitten off a lot, and I'm hoping that it's not more than he can chew to get this radio and all the stuff it's going to do out on the market at that incredibly low price. So I'm looking forward to seeing that. And once again, if you want to see the original conversation that we had, head on back to episode 138. Now, Jim McClellan, N5MIJ. Jim is a historical figure in D-Star, and he's been on ham radio now many, many times. The very first time I encountered him was when in 2008, when I was traveling around. No, I've seen him before. I saw him before that. The first time I interviewed with him and made a big deal out of it was in 2008 when I was traveling around putting together the digital voice for amateur radio program. But I don't have any graphics sitting up here. Let me float one in post-production. Make some room here. there's the DVD floating right up there. Digital voice for amateur radio, a DVD that I sold. I have not put that online yet. I may put that online sometime. It is outdated, and that's part of the reason why I haven't put it up. I'd have to add a bunch of stuff to it. It is now a historical document in its own right. And I went out to Texas, to Dallas, and interviewed Jim and Fred Varian, WD5ERD, and who's the other guy? I can't remember his name. Jim will introduce him in this short episode or this interview. And they had the first D-Star system on the air outside of any test stuff for ICOM in the U.S. It was the K5 TIT, the Texas Interconnect team. Don't know what you're thinking of. And they had the first D-Star system up back when it was only a 1200 megahertz system. And then they added the 2 meters and the 70 centimeter stuff. And they were, I think, the first repeaters on the air for those bands as well. By the time I got out there, there were D-Star repeaters around many other places. But these guys were the leading edge. Jim was also instrumental in putting together Dayton forums and getting the word out. He's had a lower profile since then, but he's still involved. There's another historical thing, something you can see on the web. It is, if I got it here, this one. I did this as a special edition because this also came out as a DVD back in 2008. And I wanted to get this on the web because this is also very historical. And it's actually in two parts. It is the 2008 D-Star Forum at the Dayton Hamvention. And that's Jim at the D-Star Forum. He took a part of that in the afternoon. But the really interesting one, the one with all the history in it, is the Friday night event, again, at the 2008 D-Star, 2008 Dayton Hamvention. The Friday night event was just fun. I was going to say boring talks about D-Star stuff that they had in the afternoon. They weren't boring, very interesting if you're fascinated by D-Star. But they were straightforward presentations. Here in this event, they just had a bunch of fun. And that's Ray Novak from ICOM, who was participating in the festivities. And they had many of the people that were, again, instrumental in launching D-Star in its popular form, the 2 meters and 70 centimeters version, from all over the country at this event. And it's never, they do the forums, they still do the forums, and they do the Friday night events. I went to the D-Star forum, stuck my head in the back. I didn't stay for the whole thing this year at Dayton. Every year it has been standing room only. This is the first one I've seen where there were some seats toward the back and not very many people standing around watching. So, you know, D-Star is practically another utility. It's the grand old man of digital voice modes on VHF and UHF. Been around for a long time. Still a lot of people who don't know very much about it. So the forums are still pretty much packed and split between people who have been using it since the beginning and the never evers and want to find out all about it. And they still do their Friday evening events. It's not at the Hamvention. It's at a hotel up on the north side of Dayton. Drury Inn is the name of it. Don't know if that's where it's always going to be, but that's where it's been for the past, since 2008. And I think they did one the year before I didn't get to. So 2007's probably the beginning of that. So anyway, I hardly recommend stopping by this special edition. It's just on the Ham Radio Now website, but I didn't give it an episode number, or did I? Yeah, let's look up at the top. No, just you'll have to do some searching. You know, I really need to clean up the website and make things easier to find. So with all that in mind, let's go see what Jim McClellan has been up to. I ran into him at Dayton at the D-Star booth. One other thing to tell you about this, I forget if we did this late on Saturday or sometime on Sunday, but whenever we did it, Cliff, who was with me for the event, was out flea marketing and looking around and doing other stuff. And I didn't feel like carrying the big heavy camera. So I just had one of the little handheld cameras and I stuck a microphone on it, the hand mic with the cool Ham Radio Now mic flag that gives us some identity out there. And so you won't see me. You'll just see Jim and you'll hear me talking and then Jim's kind of, staring at me as I'm talking and then back to him. So that's the way this is going to go. It's also the way the next one with Robin Cutshaw is going to go. So we're getting tired of carrying the big camera around. All right. On back to Dayton. Here's Jim McClellan and we'll see what he's up to.
I am still in my limited mode in the D-Star booth at the Hamvention, and I have run into an original. Jim, you did the digital voice for amateur radio program, the D-Star half, with me. I traveled to Dallas. That was about 50 years ago, wasn't it?
It's something like that. I think that was back about 8 years ago, and we were still having fun with it.
Yeah, that was a great program and a great time to be in this because it was the very leading edge of getting it pushed out big into ham radio.
Well, that was just before we had the first big growth spurt. And we have continued to grow. We're over 30,000 users now and 1,000 gateways on the system. And the fun is just beginning.
And you're still involved?
Oh, absolutely. We're still in the middle of it. Bill Moore, N5ZPR, and I have been involved since the beginning. Still having fun, still learning.
What area of D-Star are you still actively participating in besides running the repeater system in Dallas?
Well, we run the repeater system in Dallas for the K5TIT Texas Interconnect team. We also run the U.S. Root Trust Server for the Worldwide Network still. We manage that and have a team of folks spread around the world that help us support that and keep the network viable and running for the users.
That is a very background thing. It's not something the users see at all. Can you describe what it is in 25 words or less?
No, I can't do it in 25 words or less. But what happens is the network is a hub and spoke arrangement. And all of the gateways report to one common central server, which then distributes that information to all the other servers so that we always know where a user is in the network so we can route correctly to them. So the trust server is the hub of everything and keeps everything coordinated.
Now, D-Star is peer-to-peer on its networking. The audio itself doesn't go through the hub.
Oh, absolutely. The only thing that goes through the hub is the data about a user's location so it can be routed correctly. The audio is then routed directly between the two repeaters involved.
Now, back when we did the program, I asked you if there could be other networks, and you said there could be. They weren't at the time, but there could be. Now there are.
Now there are. There are at least four major networks around the world.
And what is the consequence of that?
People can operate on different networks that don't necessarily talk to each other. It's one of the fragmentations that's occurred just because people get interested in different aspects of technology. And then we're going to be looking at how we improve that for the users. And we let the networks talk to each other or combine them somehow. Right now, they're four separate networks.
One of the things about the U.S. Trust Network that I understood in the early days is that you were very careful so that when a repeater came on or someone did something that would be touching the network, that they had everything working right because it was a little too easy to break. Do I have that right?
Oh, absolutely. It still is a little too easy to break. However, we've done a pretty good job in the last couple of years of automating the process of a repeater coming onto the network. So that literally we are not manually involved unless there's a problem we have to help somebody resolve.
Could that be some of the reason why people built other networks, is that they just wanted to do their own?
Oh, absolutely. People wanted to do things a little differently, and quite honestly, some folks objected to the way we were keeping the network clean and operable, and that's okay. We're not offended by that.
Yeah, they do their own thing. People do that all the time. And so now you're working on ways to integrate the disparate networks and let people still talk everybody to everybody if they want to.
Well, we're not working on it yet. We're talking about, is it something that's desirable? Is it something that we and they want to do? So we are trying to get folks from the different groups involved in talking to each other.
So now, speaking of splintering, in addition to the network splintering, digital voice itself is splintering into multiple modes that have appeared in ham radio. D-Star was the first, P-25 was the first, then D-Star, Moto Turbo DMR, and now Yaesu. What, from your D-Star perspective, do you feel about the multiple digital signals that are going to be appearing?
I think it's a great opportunity for everybody to play. I personally don't think it's a religious war, but it is not one exclusively to the others. There's an opportunity for everybody to play in things that interest them. D-Star, for me, has some technical capabilities that the others don't have yet, and I find that very exciting. Specifically the simultaneous voice and data capability, but still unique to this technology, gives us some tools and options that just aren't available anywhere else in amateur radio for us yet.
Digital technology, though, does change and move fairly quickly outside the ham radio spectrum. How long can something like D-Star hold on, locked to a specific digital mode the way it is?
I think D-Star, having been here almost 11 years now that I've been playing with it, has already stood the test of time and growth. There's a lot of capability that we haven't even tapped yet because we're still learning about this technology. But I think that same statement is true for all the digital technologies. It's a way for amateur radio to grow in capability and in interest for users.
So you said there's some things you haven't tapped yet. Can you elaborate on any of that?
There are still some things we don't understand about how best to employ the technology. We found programs that sit on top of the technology that allow lots of capabilities. We've added programs to the gateway that offer additional capabilities. I've seen at least four different pieces of hardware at this show this weekend that will be introduced over the next few weeks and months that are going to give users a tremendous new set of capabilities, with or without the commercial radios.
So it's sort of the way D Plus became an overlay on D-Star to enhance the networking. It's that sort of addition that can still be added to it.
Oh, we still have that capability. We've added D Plus, D-Star Monitor, D-Star Query. We've added some capabilities in hardware, and I'm seeing some really exciting developments wrapped around things that are not vendor specific that can be added for the users.
Are you disappointed that no other major manufacturer started making D-Star equipment even this far along?
Oh, I'm a little disappointed, of course. I would love to have more options in hardware. But then again, if the commercial vendors don't step up, we're seeing lots of folks interested in doing it from a small company and organizational perspective. Like I said a minute ago, we had four different pieces of hardware that I've seen this weekend, either wrapped around small computers or small RF transmitters or combinations of both.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Jim. I appreciate catching up, and it looks like there's life in D-Star yet.
There is. There's still excitement, and there's still fun, and that's what it's all about. Thank you.
And my other D-Star buddy from the Digital Voice Program is Fred. How you doing, Fred?
I'm doing great, and you?
I'm doing very well. I got tired of carrying the big camera around, so that's why no one's seeing my face. A question on the way D-Star has been. When D-Star got launched, there were forums, there were meetings, there were websites, there were magazine articles, a lot of people trying to teach how D-Star worked. It was a learning curve, not a huge one, but it was a definite bump people had to get through. Did you see it that way?
I still see it that way. It's a fun learning curve for the end user. But with the advantage of YouTube and videos you've done and other people have done, a lot of that learning doesn't have to be done in a classroom. It can be done via YouTube and social media.
Yeah, but they did the class here again yesterday, and I imagine it was well attended, and ICOM put it online. So there's still lots of learning. But what I'm looking at is the splintering of digital voice into P25 and DMR and now Yaesu's C4 FM. Are they going to go through all of that too?
I think to some extent they're going to have to, but a lot of those radios are not user programmed because they're, as an example, P25, you've got to have the commercial Motorola software to do that, where in the amateur radio market, the end user gets to do all that programming.
So it's sort of a reflection of D-Star's flexibility that the other systems don't have, or with the ASU anyway, we don't know what it's going to have.
I think that's true to some extent. And you also look in the with the open protocol of D-Star developed by the JERL, you have end users that are developing software for the repeaters, as well as add-on boards to for, it's not just ICOM, there's other people that have D-Star compatible equipment, like the DV dongle and the DVEP.
Okay, so and those products are the result of an interest in D-Star, but also its longevity. It's had time for people to start putting that stuff out.
That's correct. Now you're seeing it's been around a while, and end users are starting to develop things that they want to see in the network.
All right. Thank you, Fred.
Thank you. Have a good one.
And a little cameo with Fred there at the end. Interesting comments about the state of digital voice and these pretty understanding about all the other stuff that's coming along. I do wonder if, especially Yaesu, which is going to be doing their version of networking when the Wires X gets out there, still not out there as far as I can tell. And oh, by the way, the QST review of the Yaesu stuff that I did is still coming in a couple of weeks from now when QST hits the streets about mid-August for the September issue. So I'm looking forward to that. And I still got to edit some stuff, but I'll have some companion video to that. And I am kind of wondering, when they get all their network stuff out, if they will have to or will be going through all the forums and meetings and club presentations and web stuff, or if it will be a system that is simpler in design and execution so that it doesn't need quite the boost across the learning curve that the D-Star has had. And maybe D-Star taught us everything we need to know, and everything else will just be picking up the details. We will see. All right, one more from this Dayton for this episode. I got lots more from Dayton. Still some very cool stuff coming up in a future episode as fast as I can get it edited. And I lost this afternoon. I'm going to go do some freelance. Tomorrow's all freelance. Friday's all freelance. This will be the first weekend I've been in town. We've been doing family vacations and visits and summertime stuff. So Cindy and I have been out of town quite a bit on the weekends, which is when I get a lot of things put together. So this will be the first one that I'm in town for. We were going to go out of town. We were going to go down to the beach. And Cindy said, no, I haven't had any time at home. We're going to spend the weekend at home. So I'll get some more editing done and get at least some more stuff out from Dayton. So that's coming up. But this last little piece, once again, with just the single camera pointing at Robin Cutshaw, AA4RC, and his version. Lots of people have been putting the DV dongles and DVAPs and Raspberry Pis together. He's got a version of his own. It should be probably one of the best integrated pieces. So let's see what he's doing.
I'm in limited production mode here with my little baby camera. And Robin Cutshaw, who is wearing glass. You're probably shooting video of me as I speak.
That's true. Let me get a video of you shooting video. Here we go. This is 10 seconds.
And is there going to be a glass app for the DV dongle?
There will be, although not for the DV dongle. It'll plug into the D-Star network.
Directly from the glass?
Yeah, because glass has a Wi-Fi connection, so it can talk directly to repeaters and reflectors around the world.
So you're actually working on an app for that?
I'm working on the libraries that will be used as an app for that.
Okay. Hanging off your monitor over here, you've got a new toy. What is that?
That is the DV Pi. It's basically the same thing as a DV dongle, but it's a board that plugs onto the Raspberry Pi, and it allows you to talk via Bluetooth to your phone, so now you'll be doing D-Star from your phone.
So people have been doing Raspberry Pi connections to DVAPs for a while.
Yeah.
This looks like it's going to be a little bit better integrated?
Well, it's a DV dongle as opposed to a DVAP, so now you don't need a radio. You'll use your cell phone to get access to the D-Star network.
We're getting radio out of this thing entirely.
Pretty much. But then there's no radio when you use a DV dongle on your PC.
Yeah, you're still talking to the D-Star network, I guess, and that's right. Going to go out repeaters and stuff.
Correct.
When is this likely to hit the market?
We get boards in a couple of weeks. The software will be available in a couple of months, so probably 60 days.
There's something that's kind of hidden in the background of the DVAP and DV dongles that people don't know about. It is that your connection is primarily to something called the U.S. Trust. And now there's another network. And is it now easy to connect to that other network, or are you still kind of locked to U.S. Trust?
The DV dongle and the DVAP, via the software that comes with it, talks to U.S. Trust-based systems. But there is software available from other developers that talk to all of the networks. There's actually more than two now.
Okay, so there's a bunch of networks. And if people were to watch my old show, the Digital Voice for Amateur Radio, we would have talked about that. But it's kind of been subsumed unless people know about these other networks.
Correct.
What is this going to sell for?
It's going to be a complete kit, including the Pi and everything you need, for $250.
Okay, that includes the Raspberry Pi.
Correct.
But not glass.
But not glass. Glass is a little bit more expensive than that.
Have you been having fun with the glass?
Very much so. This morning I went through before the sessions open, and I took pictures of all of the interesting things around the Hamfest, and those automatically get uploaded via Glass to Google Plus, and then I can go in, review the pictures, and release them for everybody to see. So it's a very quick turnaround of pictures to out to the internet.
This is still expensive, but it's like $1,500. More people can get them. You're pretty early in the program.
I was one of the original Glass Explorers. I got this a little before Dayton last year, and they've just opened it up for other people to buy it on glass.google.com, I believe.
Are you looking forward to it becoming more of a consumer product?
Until they drop the price, it's not going to go consumer. They really need to make it affordable. I mean, it's an Android device, just like your phone, so it should be in that same price range.
Besides what you're doing with DV dongle on it, can you see other ham radio applications?
Anywhere that, so you're talking on an HF radio and you hear somebody's call sign, you've just made a contact, you can Google their call sign right now and it'll bring up all the information that Google can find about that contact that you just made. You could go to the QRZ site and look at their QRZ page. So even without writing new apps for it, there are mechanisms to use it for ham radio.
Just doing the web-based stuff, but is your brain cooking applications that would be specific to ham radio?
There are lots of possibilities. You're only limited by imagination and, more importantly, time.
And how much of both do you have?
Well, I'm working on this as well. This is an Android tablet, a Nexus 7. And as you can see, I've got a DV dongle plugged into it, and it's all powered up. And one of the things that Android added not too long ago was USB host support, so that I can do DV dongle things with an Android tablet. So I'm working on the app for Android so that you can plug in a dongle or a DVAP and take it with you. So you've got an integrated battery, a large battery, you've got plenty of horsepower, you've got a nice display, and you plug in a DV access point dongle or a DV dongle, and now you just take D-Star with you anywhere you go.
Now, the Nexus 7, I've got one of those. It's a Wi-Fi for its connectivity, so if you're really anywhere you go, you'll have to find some other way to connect to the internet through a hotspot phone.
Although there's also a Nexus 7 with cellular built in now.
Okay, cool. So you need that or a hotspot on a Wi-Fi phone or something.
Exactly.
All right, very cool. Well, progress from Internet Labs.
Thank you.
Good talking to you.
I've checked Robin's websites, and I haven't seen any updates there either. Once again, a little bit before his timeline. I also looked around to see if any of the stills or video that he took with Glass from Dayton are up anyplace, and I couldn't find it. Looked on G+, which I'm not very good at navigating, and YouTube and some of the common places, and just some general Google searches, and didn't come up with anything. So could be he's gotten busy and didn't get it up, or could be I just wasn't able to find it. So let's see, what else? Tomorrow night, Wednesday night, I've got scheduled another BS session. And this one is going to be with Bill Pasternak, W6ITF, and Rich Moseson, W2VU from CQ editor. and Ward Silver. Ward, why can't I remember your call? They're scheduled. There's always things could happen so that it doesn't actually happen that way, but I'm hoping that will be the case. So we'll record that tomorrow night, talking about all the stuff that's going on in ham radio. There's a lot going on. And then I will run out of time to be able to put that together. No time on Thursday, no time on Friday. Maybe that'll be some of my weekend stuff, is getting that episode up. I'd like it to be current and fast and topical, but the bill pay and stuff has to come first. But speaking of the new stuff that's going on in ham radio, well, I did the episode on HR 4969, and the fellow that was not real happy with that put a note on QRZ announcing that it was going on, and talking to Mike Alexander, NADMSA, and I even on QRZ, I even stuck a link bringing the video right on the webpage, and it's finally crossed its 1,000 views. It's taken a long time considering how interesting that topic is, and it turns out that there are, Mike's got a lot of company, a lot of you out there who are not happy with the government, as you are saying, sticking their nose into private contracts. And there's some guys that are making some legalistic arguments that say that this is not a very good example of a private contract because it's got some special features to it that have been brought to you by the government, and so the government should be able to stick its nose in and modify things a little bit. But what I wanted to point out here was the very first comment that came after it from AC7DX, and this is one of those guys, the government needs to stay out of personal contracts. Very few hams out of thousands and thousands are affected. The BS propaganda that they are needed in case of emergencies is just that, BS. And something about that comment rubbed me the wrong way. And I'm not one of those folks, one of those celebrities that ignores the fans. At a certain level, you kind of have to. You're advised not to mix it up because you just go down a rabbit hole. But I'm not anywhere near that level yet. So I'll answer some things on QRZ.com when there are things like that. That was the very first comment that was made from the program. So I got on there and I looked at his post. I quoted it. And I said, well, I think JMO means just my opinion. And that's exactly what it is, an opinion. No substantiation whatsoever, and not worth the, how did I get on this rant here? Not worth the bits that it took to generate the image on my screen, but it's a free country. The bits it took to generate the image on my screen is today's version of the paper it was printed on. So, and I got called out for that by some other folks that's a little disappointed. They think my on-camera personality is a little bit mellower than that. And I responded that says, well, you know, you really can't tell from something written nearly as well as you can tell from someone staring into a camera and talking to you what their feelings are about something, what their attitude is about it. You know, the written word is, especially when it's brief, contains as much of what you're putting into it, what you're inferring from it, as what I say or imply. So that was some of my response to it. But here's the deal. Here's what I'm really thinking about here. I put a lot of effort into a program. I put it up, and someone just does a drive-by. Okay, you've wanted me to lose the headphones. I've lost the headphones. Somebody does a drive-by like that. And like I say, it's got no substantiation. It's just his opinion. Very few hams out of thousands and thousands are affected. He's got no way to back that up. And he says that it's our use in emergencies is just BS propaganda. And he doesn't have any way to back that up. And he doesn't even attempt to back that up. And so when I see something like that, it bugs me a little bit, somewhere between a little bit and a lot. And I, for some reason, decided to call him out on that one. So AC7DX, welcome to come on. You're welcome to come on the show and back something up. But to just have you blather on QRZ.com of your opinion with no substantiation, Not worth the bits it took to paint it on my screen. That's it for this episode. I guess I do sound kind of angry about that. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Arvin has been sitting here watching me saying, Gary, calm down. People make contributions. They send you good money for putting this stuff on here, and you're just going to piss them off. And I say I've made just as many people happy as I have made them mad. And that's about the best you can do. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73, and we'll do some BSing Wednesday night, and hopefully you'll get to see it over the weekend. For now, over and out.